Members of the first family skipped the final hearing in their ill-gotten wealth case before the Philippine Anti-Graft Court.
Interior Secretary Benhur Abalos set to hold another talk with Cebu City Mayor Michael Rama for pushing through with the implementation of the eased face mask mandate.
Various Philippine provinces preparing for the possible onslaught of Super Typhoon Henry.
And monkeypox cases across the world hit 50,000.
Good afternoon, I'm Ron Crow.
And I'm Denise Dinsai.
You're watching Top Source. Members of the first family, a no-show in the last hearing in their ill-gotten wealth case before the Philippine Anti-Graft Court. Former First Lady Imelda Marcos, her daughters Aimee and Irene, as well as another defendant, failed to present evidence as they were not represented by lawyers. This prompted the prosecution to ask the court to declare that they have already waived their right to present evidence. Second Division Chairperson Oscar Herrera granted the motion. President Marcos himself earlier decided not to present his own evidence. The case involves the recovery of alleged ill-gotten wealth, which the Marcoses supposedly acquired through the improper use of funds or properties owned by government.
Turning now to the sugar mess, the Philippine Customs Bureau reinstates six of its officials who were relieved last week amid a probe into alleged sugar smuggling at the Subic port in Zambales. Customs Chief Yogi Filemon Ruiz says the probe found documents for the shipments were in line with its regulations and there was no negligence on the part of the officials. The BOC last month seized some 7,000 metric tons of sugar from Thailand at the Subic port.
Senator Francis Tolentino looking to wrap up his committee's probe into the sugar importation fiasco soon. He says the Senate Blue Ribbon Committee can draft an initial report after one more hearing. He adds they're looking to recommend changes to the system of the Sugar Regulatory Administration, not its abolition.
Within the SO number 4, there's a provision there that the board's decision would have to be lodged on a single person alone, and that's Mr. Serafica. It really has to be a collegial body deciding for the sugar industry, and the powers of the administrators should be clipped for mere internal administration within the agency. And the matter of reclassifying should really be based on market needs and decisions coming from the board based on real consultation. So we can thrash this out and make finer provisions in our proposed amendments.
For Senate Minority Leader Coco Pimentel, the probe should not be concluded until they question Executive Secretary Vic Rodriguez. Senators want more clarity over his role in crafting the botched sugar importation order. Rodriguez skipped Tuesday's hearing, and he will likely snub the next one.
We will still endeavor to invite him if he can be present via Zoom virtually, just like what we're doing.
Yeah.
So be it. There are just two points that need clarification. If you look at the transcript of the stenographic notes during the last hearing, one, the perception of the SRA members that they were given the go signal to proceed with the SO number 4. But SO number 4 was aborted by the executive department itself. So with the claim of the good executive secretary, and here the presumption is good faith, is that it was a mere draft. The meeting that took place between the SRA members and the executive secretary, and the other one was the non-answering of the text messages.
A group of agriculture workers, meanwhile, says the shortfall in sugar supply is not as bad as it is portrayed. The group believes the shortage is minimal and should not result in increased prices. It also calls the government's position on the sugar importation mess confusing.
Ang hindi lang namin talaga maano dito is yung very confusing at contradicting din yung posisyon ng Malacanang palagi. Sabi niya kasi mayroong artificial shortage at may nag-hoard ng supply ng asukal. At the same time is aminable naman siya sa pag-import, no, ng 150,000 metric tons. Yung mga rails na ito, para sa amin, nagpapakita ito na hindi ganun kalala yung ano, yung shortfall natin.
Meanwhile, local sugar producers asking for clarity on the proposed importation of 150,000 metric tons of sugar. In a joint letter addressed to acting SRA Administrator David John Tadeus Alba, the sugar producers urged the SRA to release the data they used as reference so that they can reconcile it with their own.
Cebu City implements its relaxed mask rule despite pushback from the Health and Interior Departments. It was DILG Secretary Benner Abalos who said Cebu City Mayor Michael Rama agreed to defer enforcing the policy. But locals in Cebu City were able to go out without wearing face masks Thursday and they were not apprehended. Mayor Rama confirmed meeting with Abalos, but he asserts they will continue to promote the use of face masks through self-regulation.
Importante ngayon, nire-review ko yung executive order ko. Wala naman ako dapat actually ililip. Wala naman akong sinasabing huwag na kayong mag-wear ng face mask. Ang ginagawa ko, non-obligatory lang.
Rama also saying it's about time for government's COVID task force to recalibrate its pandemic policies.
Ayoko lang yung statement ng DOH na sinasabi ng DOH na kukonsultahin pa namin sila. Ayoko yun. Kasi sa local government code po, kaya naman doon. Sila yung kukonsult sa amin. Kami yung ini-elect. Kami yung nandun sa baba. Alam namin yung nangyayari sa baba. Dapat nirespeto rin yung sitwasyon na yan. I wish yung IETF, kung nandyan pa sila, they should be more circumspect kasi iba-iba itong peculiarities natin all over the country.
As it stands, Cebu City only requires the wearing of face masks in hospitals and other medical facilities. Meanwhile, the country's interior chief surprised by Cebu City's decision to keep its relaxed face mask mandate. Secretary Benner Abalos says Cebu City Mayor Michael Rama committed on Wednesday that he will defer the policy until the Interagency Task Force on Infectious Diseases issues a decision on the face mask use. Abalos notes he will again ask Mayor Rama to reconsider.
Hindi tayo pwede magkanya-kanya rito, no? I know, he has good intentions, very good intentions at that. Pero I'm sure, kung ipipresent ko naman sa IETF ito, baka payagan naman ipilot ang Cebu. But until such time, baka po pwede sumunod muna tayo rito sa tamang proseso. Yun naman ang pinakiusap ko sa kanya kahapon at sabi niya, okay raw, pumapayag siya.
The mask mandate stays nationwide. The Health Department's officer in charge, Maria Rosario Vergeres, says the agency respects the autonomy of local governments. But she points out the law states under a public health emergency, local leaders should follow protocols issued by the national government. Vergeres asserts vaccination coverage and the healthcare system must first be approved before the mask mandate can be eased.
The Department of Health positions that the mask is still very much protective of our population, that the mask mandate should continue on until we can be able to improve our vaccination coverage and therefore have that kind of safeguard. That's where the problem lies, because everybody of us, local governments, national government, should always prioritize public health. there would always be this autonomy for local governments. But in this time of the pandemic, we should act as one nation. We cannot be implementing different policies because, as I've said, this virus crosses borders.
For the Philippine Nurses Association, it's not yet time to ease the face mask mandate. The group's national president says they will coordinate with their members from Cebu City to continue promoting the use of face masks. The PNA asserts the public should not be complacent.
Kami pa rin po ay tumutugon pa rin na ipatupad ang minimum public health standard. So doon pa rin kami sa scientific basis kung bakit kailangan pa rin po natin mag-face mask. So sa ganun man, dahil pa rin pa tayo nasa alert level 1, kami nga po ay nakikipag-dialogo po doon sa aming pong PNA Cebu chapter na para ma-campaign pa rin ang minimum public health standards.
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. vows to improve the lives of Filipino nurses. Speaking during the 100th anniversary celebration of the Philippine Nurses Association, Marcos says his administration will address the wage gap among private and government nurses. He adds their current benefits are not enough.
As of 19 August of this year, the government has disbursed a total of 25.82 billion pesos worth of benefits to our healthcare workers, especially our nurses.
Sa palagay ko, kulang pa yan eh. Medyo hirap tayo sa pondo ngayon. Kaya sa ngayon, ganyan lang muna. Pero palagay ko, binubuhay nyo yung may sakit eh. Ibang usapan yan, walang mahirap lagyan ng balor, ng dolyar, ng piso, yung trabahong ginagawa ninyo.
Marcos also says government will open more slots for the deployment of Filipino nurses abroad. The Philippines earlier imposed a 7,500 deployment cap for healthcare workers going abroad due to the pandemic.
I think I am correct when I say no other country can boast of such a strong and capable nurses who are known not just for competence and dedication to this very noble calling of healthcare, but for their compassion and kindness. As we work hard to improve the state of our healthcare system at home, let us join hands to maintain our country's position as the gold standard when it comes to providing healthcare workers to hospitals and health facilities globally. We will open more slots for the deployment of nurses abroad while striving to improve opportunities domestically.
Several House lawmakers point out a budget cut in the proposed funding for the UP Philippine General Hospital goes against President Marcos's vow to expand health care services. Zen Hernandez reports.
The All-UP Workers Union calls a possible budget cut for the UP Philippine General Hospital unfair and unacceptable. Workers are concerned about its possible impact on benefits, since even allowances for work rendered in COVID operations have yet to be paid.
Tiisin mo yung uhaw, yung gutom. Pag-uwi mo sa bahay, hindi mo alam, baka may bitbit ka. Parang wala lang, parang hero is nothing.
The UPPGH management clarified funds for the one COVID allowance come from the Department of Health. They have written a letter to the DOH, and the DOH confirmed receiving the said letter. But funds for the said benefits have yet to be distributed.
Ang nangyari ngayon, yung MOOE natin sa national government through DOH ay naubos na at hindi na natin, wala na tayong ma-issue pa. So we have already requested since I think that was May or June from DBM, for them to release funds to us so that we can pay for the other healthcare workers who have not received their COVID allowance.
The UPPGH, meanwhile, is hoping for its own budget of 6.1 billion pesos for 2023. But under the budget department's proposal, only 5.9 billion pesos was allocated for hospital services and medical assistance to indigent patients. According to UPPGH, though proposed budget is enough to fund operational expenses, salaries of workers, and free services, it will affect infrastructure projects and further equipment upgrade.
Yung cath lab, isang malaking equipment yan. Talagang dyan ginagawa mga major heart procedures. Yung po mga linear accelerator naman, ginagamit po pang diagnose ng mga iba-ibang sakit. At treatment po, actually, ng cancer. Meron din po kaming CT scan at MRI na pinandadagdag sa ating mga servisyo. Lahat po yan ay kasama sa pagda-diagnose at eventually tamang paggagamot ng ating mga kababayan.
For the Makabayan and Minority Bloc at the House of Representatives, the economic team's proposed budget go against the president's promise to expand healthcare services while also showing a lack of appreciation for health workers whom the president called modern-day heroes.
Hindi siya consistent doon sa sinabi ng Pangulo na dapat ay i-improve pa itong mga specialty hospitals. Kabilang dyan syempre yung PGH. Dahil nandiyan talaga yung mga magagaling na doktor, specialization, andiyan din. Pati nga itong yung budget para doon sa hazard pay ng mga health workers natin ay nilagay pa sa unprogrammed fund. Bakit mo ilalagay sa unprogrammed fund na mag-iintay pa ng budget para maibigay na sa ating mga health workers?
But the budget department explains the 5.1% cut on the hospital's allocation.
Yung reduction po kasi na ito, ito po yung mga Congress introduced changes and adjustments and yung mga non-recurring programs and projects po. Ibig po sabihin, ito yung mga one-time purchase po. For example po sa UPPGH, kung bibili po tayo ng mga equipment po, kunyari X-ray machine or similar medical equipment po, one time lang po ito binibili. Wala, hindi po kailangan po doon sa sunod na taon.
UPPGH says it's more than willing to justify the need for higher funding in ongoing budget deliberations. Zen Hernandez, ABS-CBN News.
The proposed confidential funds of the Office of the Philippine Vice President to be used for projects on peace and order and national security. Vice President Sara Duterte's office has asked for a budget of nearly 2.3 billion pesos for next year, including 500 million pesos in confidential expenses. Her predecessor, Lenny Robredo, had no such funds in her budget for 2022. Duterte's office vows transparency in the utilization of its proposed budget.
Of course, the position and mandate of the Vice President allows her to utilize those kinds of funds regarding peace and order and national security. Especially, we have livelihood projects that will be implemented in conflict areas. In our attempt to maintain peace order and pursue national security projects.
The Philippine Commission on Elections says its preparations for the village youth council polls are 80% complete. This comes as lawmakers look to defer the December 2022 elections to next year. Let's get details now. We have on the line ABS-CBN correspondent Joyce Balancho. Hi, Joyce.
Yes, Ron, the Commission on Elections, or COMELEC, said Monday that their preparations for the barangay in Sangguniang Kabataan elections scheduled on December will not go to waste. This despite calls from lawmakers to defer the elections to next year as they insist that funds that are intended for the conduct of the polls should instead be used for other important projects of the administration. COMELEC Chairman George Irwin Garcia at the Laging Handa public briefing said that the preparations for the elections are almost 80% complete and they will continue to make everything ready while Congress has not yet decided on the bill. In the days to come, the Commission will issue resolutions which will contain guidelines on the conduct of the polls. They will also proceed with the scheduled printing of the ballot. In case a law is passed to defer again the elections, Garcia said, the printed ballots, the ballot boxes, ballpens, and all other election paraphernalia will still be used for the conduct of the next polls. He, however, stressed that if the election will be moved to next year, the commission would need 17 billion pesos if it will be scheduled on May, or 18 billion pesos if it will be deferred to December. Barangay Sangguniang elections were last held in 2018, and since then, it has been deferred a couple of times because of the COVID-19 pandemic, among other reasons. Ron?
Joyce Balancho with that story. Thanks, Joyce.
Residents of Batanes bracing for Super Typhoon Henry, which threatens to dump heavy rains over parts of northern Luzon. Fishermen there have been advised not to set sail, while farmers were told to salvage their crops. Henry is not expected to make landfall, but it may still bring rains and strong winds in parts of Luzon.
Other provinces in Luzon are also preparing for the possible onslaught of Henry. The Disaster Management Office in Cagayan says it has already activated 7 task force groups across the province. Floating assets, evacuation trucks, and rescue vehicles have been deployed as well. Further up north in Ilocos Norte, disaster officials have also pre-positioned food items in areas that may be affected by the super typhoon. The town of Masantol in Pampanga placed under a state of calamity due to massive flooding. 26 villages are affected. The local government says it will use its quick response funds for flood control projects.
All the 26 barangays po epektado. Lahat po. Average po ng water level, ng average height po ng baha eh nasa 1.5 feet to 3 feet po. Naka-prepare na po ang mga evacuation centers natin and suwat po tayo sa mga paaralan na kung pwede, kung kakailanganin, eh maging evacuation centers po ang ating mga paaralan.
Up next, 7 Filipino teachers now under probe for alleged sexual abuse.
And rights advocates laud a UN report on the alleged crimes against humanity in China's Xinjiang region. More news when we return.
Back with more news. An update on the probe into the alleged sexual abuses committed by public school teachers in Cavite. The Education Department says the number of teachers under investigation has risen to 7. A fact-finding report expected to be submitted by Friday. DepEd spokesperson Michael Poa assures the public the agency has taken steps to ensure the safety of learners.
Because ang feedback rin po sa amin is that although nagtutuloy yung investigasyon natin, ang problema is walang masyadong mga complainants na nagpa-file ng kanilang mga affidavits. So sana po tulungan niyo rin kami ikayatin yung mga alleged victims na lumabas po at mag-file ng kanilang affidavits para po mapalakas lalo yung kaso kung meron man. Si Vice President at Secretary Sara Duterte already had a meeting the other day with the Child Protection Unit. Kasi po sa atin sa DepEd, meron po tayong Child Protection Unit na tinatalaga at tinalaga na noong 2020 para po sa mga problemang ganyan, para sa mga abuses against our learners. So there were major directions being given to the Child Protection Unit to strengthen their presence, to strengthen their programs on the school level, doon po sa SDO level at RO level.
The Philippine Commission on Human Rights is conducting an independent probe into sexual harassment claims in a public high school in Bacoor, Cavite. Details from ABS-CBN News correspondent Michael Joe Delizo. Michael, go ahead.
Hi, Denise. The Commission on Human Rights in the Calabarzon region said it is already in the process of getting in touch with at least 30 students over sexual harassment claims in a public high school in Bacoor, Cavite. In an interview with ABS-CBN News, CHR Calabarzon Regional Director Attorney Rexford Guevara said they are conducting an independent probe and will be ready to provide legal, psychosocial, and financial assistance upon evaluation of the victim's affidavits. The CHR Calabarzon has already required the concerned school to present its comments detailing the actions they have already taken and other preventive measures. Guevara expressed alarm on the increasing sexual harassment claims.
alarming kasi dito sa Region 4A, hindi lang ito yung una na natanggap naming sexual harassment sa school. There's another one in Laguna na amin din siyang ini-investigate. So very alarming kasi parang dumadami siya.
The CHR Calabarzon is also investigating sexual harassment claims of several high school students in a state-run school in Los Baños, Laguna. Guevara advises other victims to seek CHR's legal assistance. Back to you, Denise.
Thanks, Michael.
A clarification from Trade Secretary Alfredo Pascual. He says he does not want general education subjects in higher education removed. Pascual asserts he just wants those subjects to be included in the K-12 program.
Yung grades 11 and 12 ngayon sa senior high school, yun ang dating katapat, yun ang katapat ng dating first and second year sa college. Kasi ba binibigay yung general education bago na K-12, hindi ba sa first 2 years ng college? O ngayon nadagdag na yung 2 additional years sa high school, eh yung edad na yon, yun ang tamang-tamang bigyan ng general education at mas marami sila na naka-enroll sa senior high school kaysa sa college. So mas maraming kabataan natin ang mapapalawak natin ang pag-iisip sa pamagitan ng general education.
Pascual also reiterates his call for a review of the K-12 program. The Education Department asserts a review is underway to make sure grade 12 graduates are highly employable.
The pronouncement of Secretary Pascual is also in line naman with the current review that we are doing right now. As we have mentioned, we are currently focusing also on grades 11 and 12 specifically doon sa ating tech track na gusto natin sana once they graduate from grade 12, they are employable. So how do we do that? Skills matching.
The Philippine Coast Guard and their American counterparts take part in a school maintenance program in Tondo, Manila. Bianca Dava now on the line for an update. Bianca?
Hi, Denise. The Philippine Coast Guard and United States Coast Guard joined the Brigada Escuela at the Jose Rizal Elementary School in Tondo, Manila on Thursday. Around 100 personnel from the PCG and 20 from the USCG helped clean, repaint, and repair school facilities. They donated school supplies and toys for the students. The personnel also read books and organized games for the children. The USCG Cutter Midget arrived in the vicinity waters off Manila Bay on Tuesday to kick off the joint search and rescue exercise, or SARECS, of the two Coast Guards. The SARECS will be held off the coast of Lubang Occidental, Mindoro this Friday and Saturday. According to the PCG, the activity aims to enhance the maritime interoperability of the two countries. Around 250 personnel from the USCG and 150 from the PCG will participate in the exercise. According to the PCG, despite the threat of Super Typhoon Henry, the exercise will push through. Now, the activities for the SARECS include communication exercises, maneuvering, technical demonstrations, flight operations, small boat operations, medical assistance, and resolution. The PCG and USCG will also have a friendship basketball game after the Brigada Escuela. Denise?
Thanks, Bianca.
Former Philippine Vice President Lenny Robredo, named as a Hauser leader by Harvard Kennedy School Center for Public Leadership for the fall semester. As a Hauser leader, Robredo will hold a series of engagements with students, faculty, and other members of the Harvard community in the U.S. Robredo says it's humbling and thrilling to be given the chance to share her advocacies and experiences. Four other Hauser leaders have been chosen, including former U.S. Representative Jane Harman.
The illegal drug cases against detained former Philippine Senator Laila de Lima may be due for resolution by year-end. Supreme Court Administrator Raul Villanueva told the House Appropriations Committee de Lima's two remaining cases are continuously being heard in a Muntinlupa court. Villanueva noted the cases will be submitted for decision as long as the parties present their evidence in due time. De Lima has been detained since February 2017 for allegedly pocketing drug payoffs from convicted crime lords when she was Justice Secretary. She has slammed the charges as political persecution. One drug case against her was dismissed in February last year.
The Energy Regulatory Commission vows to decide soon on San Miguel Corporation's petition for a temporary power rate hike. More from Alvin El Chico.
Consumer baby Nestor is looking for ways to reduce her electricity bill as Meralco has already issued a disconnection notice for non-payment.
Wala na nga kaming TV, hindi na kami nagti-TV. Ang electric pa namin, tigi-isa lang. Kahit anong tipid ang gawin namin, ganun pa rin.
But consumers like Baby will have to prepare for even higher bills in the coming months. The Philippine Electricity Market Corporation confirms it will be more expensive for Meralco to source power from the spot market in case one of its major suppliers stops its supply contract with the country's largest power distribution utility. San Miguel Corporation, Sual and Ilihan power plants may terminate its supply contract if the Energy Regulatory Commission fails to grant its petition to raise rates by 30 centavos per kilowatt hour for 6 months in order to partially recover staggering fuel costs since January 2022.
Kung ibabase natin sa trend ngayon ng presyohan sa merkado, and when I say merkado po yung lesson, mataas po ngayon ang presyohan natin sa market natin. Nag-range ng around 6 pesos to 8 pesos per kilowatt hour. And so if that's the case, and assuming that the approved contract po ng Meralco at ng San Miguel, yung kanilang Ilihan plant, natural gas plant, is less than that, then the logic says that mas mataas, tataas po ang presyo ng Meralco end users dito. Madalang akong makakita, Sir Alvin, ng kontrata na inaaprubahan ng ERC na umaabot ng 6 to 8. So if the market is on that price level, I'm assuming the price contract ng Meralco at San Miguel is mas mababa. So yung difference po ng 6 to 8 minus 440, that's the additional kumbaga presyo na ipapatong sa Meralco breakdown of costs.
Meralco admits all options now translate to higher electricity rates, but the one with the least impact is still San Miguel's offer to adjust rates by 30 centavos per kilowatt hour for 6 months.
Kung magpo-pull out si San Miguel, mawawalan kami ng kontrata sa kanila, mapipilitan kaming kumuha sa WESM ng kapalit na kuryente. Pagka sa WESM ka kukuha, makakaasa ka, medyo mas mataas ang presyo doon compared dito sa presyo ng San Miguel. At kung after naman ng WESM at ma-approve na yung mga bagong kontrata, yun na nga yung bagong offer na sinasabi ko sa iyo na nagre-range na ng 780 to almost 12 pesos per kilowatt hour.
For ordinary consumers like Baby, there's not much choice.
Sana naman, wag naman nilang taasan ng sobra para naman makayana ng mga tao. Lalo na ngayong pasukan, gastusan na naman.
While Energy Regulatory Commission Chair Mona Lisa Dimalanta promised an equitable decision soon, cause-oriented groups are still protesting as it appears that whatever the ruling is, it still means higher rates for consumers. Alvin Olchico, ABS-CBN News.
Telco and cable companies here in the Philippines step up efforts to crack down on illegal cable cutting. The details from Jackie Pascual.
Telco and cable companies have banded together to fight illegal cable cutting. They signed a manifesto on Oplan Contra Putol, an industry-wide effort against cable theft which has been on the rise this year. One recent case happened in Manila where two men are believed to have cut the cable wire and possibly sold the copper inside, affecting many residents.
Nag-online ng bata, so ang laking adjustment talaga, ang hirap. Pati kami, meron din kami mga personal use yan, pati sa business, nagka-problema, hindi kami makakontak. So talagang perwisyong.
The company say, aside from affecting individual subscribers, cable theft also has an impact on the economy, with many businesses relying on the internet.
Yung kable natin ay sinasadyang putulin, either upang nakawin or somehow interrupt the signal. Some ibinibenta ito sa mga junk shops.
They we already considered right now internet as a utility
a service just like water and electricity. So once it's been cut, especially during the time that when you're doing this kind of face-to-face, during this kind of virtual meeting, it really affects really the service.
Sky Cable says nearly 400 incidents of cable theft have been reported in Metro Manila and nearly 200 in Cebu since January this year. That's double the over 200 incidents in Metro Manila for the whole of last year.
Minsan sa isang araw, meron kami 5-6 na incidents affecting nga mga 40,000 to 50,000 or even as high as 80,000 subscribers. Apektado pag-aaral, trabaho, kabuhayan ng mga ating customers.
They now hope for more collaboration among telco and cable companies as well as local government units.
The partnership of the government agencies and the local communities is very important in order for us to be able to prosecute the perpetrators of illegal cutting. It should be a concerted effort of all the stakeholders in order to address this illegal cutting.
Globe has given its support to the group. It asserts cable theft has caused network disruptions and has deprived customers of seamless connectivity. PLDT Smart also urges the public to be more vigilant and to report incidents of cable theft in their community. Jackie Pascual, ABS-CBN News.
Several towns in Occidental Mindoro are grappling with power outages. Dennis Dato now joins us for more on that story. Dennis?
Yes, Denise, 5 towns in Occidental Mindoro are experiencing blackout following the shutdown of the Occidental Mindoro Consolidated Power Corporation, or OMCPC, the main power plant that supplies electricity to the province electric cooperative Umeco. According to OMCPC Chief Operating Officer Calvin Luper Hirotiba, they were forced to shut down at around 2 p.m. due to fuel shortage. This prompted a blackout in the towns of San Jose, Magsaysay, Rizal, Kalintaan, and Sablayan. Hirotiba explained that there was a delay in the delivery of fuels due to limited ships that are allowed to transport dangerous cargoes from Batangas Port. This could have been prevented if they have sufficient funding to purchase and serve fuels. This was not a problem before, and they actually can store up to 1 million liters of fuel. However, they still have uncollected subsidies from Umeco and National Power Corporation amounting to 258 million pesos. The Energy Regulatory Commission, or ERC, has already ordered Umeco to pay the half of the subsidies due to the delays in the competitive selection process for the selection of a new power provider in Occidental Mindoro. The local government has condemned the said shutdown. Right now, some towns, including Santa Cruz, Mamburao, Paluan, and Abra de Ilog, still have power supply, but this may not be the case if the problem will still persist. Denise?
Thanks, Dennis. A digital advocacy group says it's possible private companies and government agencies were exposed to a data breach amid the spread of personalized spam text messages. Ronald Gustilo, national campaigner for Digital Pinoy, says it's unlikely for spammers to collect data from physically written forms because that would be more tedious to do. The group is calling on the National Privacy Commission to investigate if local companies collecting personal information are selling the data to third parties.
Definitely, identity theft is a possibility. They were able to get hold of your name. It's a possibility that they could have your other personal information like your birthday, your address, which could lead to identity theft. Then one day, you'll be surprised. You owe a company a large amount of money because somebody used your personal information to claim that you are the one who spent it. I think we should thoroughly review the SIM card registration bill because while it is a measure that it is said being said to an attempt to thwart the spam text, there are also other ways to send spam text, like text blasting machines. We have SIM cloning. So one concern about SIM card registration is that it could also lead to data breach because the government will be collecting your personal information along with your SIM number.
Consumer loan specialist Home Credit says borrowing through non-bank institutions is on the rise. It also expects consumer loans to continue to grow in spite of monetary policy tightening by the Philippine Central Bank. Warren de Guzman reports.
Philippine Central Bank Governor Felipe Medalla has not been shy when it comes to hiking interest rates to anchor inflation expectations. And he has also been frank in admitting that tightening of monetary policy would slow borrowing and economic activity. However, Home Credit Philippines, an international consumer loan specialist with operations across Asia and parts of Europe, has not seen this in the Philippines.
I would not say that there is impact on the consumption from the monetary tightening at this point in time. When it comes to the monetary policy tightening, I think BSP is doing a great job to protect peso from further weakening. They are doing a great job in response to the Fed steps on changes in the rates in U.S. and we support BSP strategy, and I am positive that the job that is done will help Philippines to go through this macroeconomic challenges.
Home Credit Philippines has been in the country since 2013, present in 10,000 points of sale, online and mobile, offering loans to non-credit card holders, provided they have valid IDs and settlement accounts. They've noted Filipinos continue to borrow in spite of higher interest rates and other challenging conditions. They continue to pay as well.
Home Credit is known for financing mobile phones. But recently, it's very important are the laptops. So with the back-to-school season, we grew a lot of our business in the laptops. And in recent years, when people are focused more on different type of the exercise where they can do social financing. Also, for example, bikes became very popular for financing. But when it comes to the diligence of our customers, we are very happy with the performance of our portfolio. So it is doing well.
The latest data from the Philippine Central Bank show consumer loan growth accelerated in July. It was 14.7% year-on-year that month, compared to just 10.9% in June. Salary loans surged by 39.1% year-on-year from a growth of just 13.2% the month before. Credit card loans grew 21%, up slightly from a 19.5% expansion in June. RCBC Chief Economist Michael Ricafort says overall loan growth could accelerate again in the coming months as economic activity increases. Ricafort, however, says borrowing could slow if the central bank does pull the trigger on higher interest rates to continue its fight against inflation. Warren de Guzman, ABS-CBN News.
The PSE index barely changed at the start of the new trading month, but shares of media giant ABS-CBN still saw deep cuts. Michelle Ong tells us why in this report.
Risk aversion continues to hit sentiment in Asia, with stocks and futures down again on Thursday as investors still fret over a more hawkish Fed in its battle against inflation. Market watcher John Mangan sees more short-term pullback before an upward trajectory, saying there's a ton of money just waiting on the sidelines for now.
Got to go down another 100 or so points to fill a trading gap at, 6470. Once that trading gap gets filled, then we have an opportunity to go higher. In terms of the economy, everything is opening up. It's going to be good through the rest of the year. And regarding the U.S., they got their own problems. It really doesn't concern us. But every time oil tries to get above $100 a barrel, it goes back down. If you're interested in the longer term, then what you're going to be looking at is earnings growth. And earnings are growing. If you're interested in the short term, volatility is the most wonderful thing in the world, because you can play the swings.
For the day, the PSE index was tentative, closing flat at 65.88 and very thin value turnover. In corporate stories, ABS-CBN Corporation, the parent of this news channel, and TV5 have mutually agreed to terminate the investment agreement signed last month, where the Lopez-led company was supposed to acquire 34.99% of TV5 of the MVP Group. Also terminated, the purchase by Signal Cable of the MVP Group of 38.88% of Sky Cable from the Lopez Group. The deals were earlier paused to give both parties time to address issues raised by several lawmakers. ABS-CBN went into an hour-long voluntary trading halt, eventually closing at 9:14 apiece, down 15% for the day. Market observers say the news does not come as a big surprise.
Too bad, but maybe in the future in another form or that's acceptable to regulators and the rest, sana it can be resurrected because it would be good for the economy and for the consumers.
They rolled the dice and it's not going to work. I hate to see it happen, but there's got to be other alternatives, non-controversial alternatives. We need better and more free TV in the Philippines. Anytime there's a whole bunch of money on the table, there's going to be politics involved. Mm-hmm. And yes, this is, I wouldn't say it's a political issue per se, but politics is also part of it. And this is not the time at the beginning of a new administration to get into a situation where you have a toxic political issue for what should really be a business issue.
Meanwhile, Frutas Holdings ventures into cloud kitchens, which will carry the Noob Cucina brand. The F&B and kiosk operator says it will put together existing food brands including Balay Pandesal, Lingnam, Sabroso Lechon, and the original Jamaican patty and make these more accessible to customers. Frutas is in an aggressive expansion mode through physical stores, now totaling 720 nationwide, its e-commerce website, and the cloud kitchen. In other news, Asia United Bank joins the Buy Now, Pay Later wave, partnering with platform provider Atome and Singapore-based fintech MatchMove to launch Atome Card in the country. The banking arm of the Rubisco Group says the card will allow Filipino consumers flexibility to pay in installments without having to worry about interest rate hikes in the future. The card will carry no annual fees and will have a 45-day window and up to 200,000 pesos limit. Atome was officially launched in the Philippines back in October of 2021 and currently has over 600 online and offline partner retailers. All over Asia, it has 15,000 merchant partners in 10 markets. And finally, Ramon Ang's Eagle Cement converts its 750,000 preferred shares in fly ash and bottom ash manufacturer Armstrong into common shares, making Armstrong a subsidiary where it has a 78.95% stake. Eagle had paid 75 million pesos for the preferred shares back in 2016. The shares were converted with a ratio of 1:1. Michelle Long, ABS-CBN News.
World news now. Global monkeypox cases now over 50,000. 16 deaths have also been reported this year to the World Health Organization, which declared the outbreak a global public health emergency in July. But the WHO is seeing signs that transmission is slowing in virus hotspots in Europe and the U.S. The U.S. remains to be the country with the most cases of monkeypox, with over 18,000.
China may have committed crimes against humanity in its Xinjiang region. That's according to the long-awaited report of outgoing United Nations Human Rights Chief Michelle Bachelet. That report said patterns of torture allegations against Uyghurs and other Muslims in Xinjiang were credible. It adds the rights situation there requires urgent international attention. Bachelet released the report just minutes before her four-year term ended Wednesday. China is accused of detaining more than 1 million Uyghurs and other Muslim minorities in the region. But it denies the accusations, calling the network of prisons and camps in Xinjiang training centers.
Rights advocates laud the UN report on Xinjiang. For the Uyghur Human Rights Project, the report is incredibly strong, even as it avoided the word genocide. They also commend the release of the report, considering pressure from China to change its content.
The Uyghur community didn't need to see this report to understand what's happening. They understand 100% full well. They've understood for years. They have been pushing back against this because their families have been through these camps. I think it is still incredibly frustrating for them to be able to see this and say, yes, we knew it was crimes against humanity 3 or 4 years ago.
Meanwhile, a campaigner for Amnesty International says the report should be a wake-up call to the international community on the human rights violations in Xinjiang. She insists there is ample evidence the Chinese government is committing grave rights abuses.
This report really lays bare the scale, the severity of human rights abuses that are taking place in Xinjiang. It mirrors reporting by Amnesty and other organizations. If the Chinese government needs to release everybody detained in the camps and to allow independent observers into Xinjiang. The Chinese government has claimed in response to this report that it's the findings of the report are not true. And the onus now is really on them to substantiate their claims that the findings of the report aren't true.
Before we go, a check on the weather here in the Philippines. Super Typhoon Henry slightly weakens, but Batanes and the northeastern portion of Babuyan Islands have already been placed under signal number one. Moderate to heavy rains may prevail over those areas. Henry has maximum sustained winds of 185 kilometers per hour and gusts of up to 230 kilometers per hour. And those were the top stories today. I'm Denise Tinsay.
And I'm Ron Crows. You can watch exclusive content and highlights and recaps of our shows online. Thank you for watching.